Okay, good afternoon. I'd like to call the East Chicago Board of Works Public Meeting to order, October 26, 2011. Roll call.
Val Gomez.
Present.
Jethro Rodriguez.
Here.
Carla Morgan.
Present.
We have the regular meeting minutes from the meeting of October 12, 2011. Can I have a motion to accept them as written?
I move it.
I second it.
Roll call.
Val Gomez.
Yes.
Jethro Rodriguez.
Yes.
Carla Morgan.
Yes.
Okay. Do we have any correspondence?
Yes.
We have a...
Yes.
We have a letter of interest for 1311 to 1319 East Chicago Avenue. Is this it right here? Let's see.
Yes.
To the City of East Chicago. Hello, my name is Ark. How do you pronounce?
I think it's Eric.
Eric.
Mizrachi.
I am the owner of Maccabi Auto Supply at 1310 East Chicago Avenue. I am interested in purchasing and investing in the land at 1311 to 1319 East Chicago Avenue. I would like to speak to you in regards to this property. Please contact me at 219-678-2877. Thank you for your time. I look forward to hearing from you soon. Is anybody in the audience here for that? Can you please come to the podium? And if you give us your name and address and...
Good evening. My name is John Sfullos. I reside at 1733 Poplar Lane in Munster, Indiana. And I'm here with Mr. Mizrachi, who wrote the letter. I, along with a few other investors, including Mr. Mizrachi, are interested in acquiring the property, the vacant parcels that are currently at the corner of Euclid and Chicago Avenue. Mr. Mizrachi's business, as you know, is directly across the street and has a very vested interest in the redevelopment of that part of the city. We would be interested in acquiring that parcel to redevelop it and establish retail food as well as establish a gas station at the site.
Is this something that we would refer them to the planning department or?
I think for the actual, once they submit a site plan, yes. As far as inquiring about the ownership of the property and that sort of thing, Board of Works does own that parcel, so we can entertain proposals and eventually bids for that property since we have multiple people now interested in that. So ultimately, once you have a site plan, then we'll go to our planning department. But do you have any sort of a formal proposal for your, just a general overview of your development plan?
Formal, no. However, we can obviously get that to you at a later date. At this point, what we wanted to do is at least get in front of the board and express our interest in the acquisition of that property and explain that we have the financial wherewithal, have a vested interest in the community, obviously with Mr. Mizrachi's connection to the property directly across the street. And the rest of the investor group, we have a long track record, a successful track record of developing projects. And we are very interested in acquiring this piece of parcel.
Have you developed other Lake County projects?
We've had a long track record in developing other residential and commercial projects in the area. Hmm. And I myself have an extensive banking history.
So, in effect, this is basically making an introduction and explaining your plans before
Correct.
The board?
Correct. And we can... If you'd like, we can set a time and appointment to meet with you and the rest of the board to go over more details of the project.
Hmm. Would this be something that would be, we would meet with them at a board meeting or separate?
If you want to meet with the board in its entirety, we'd have to advertise a meeting. If you are looking to meet with, say, our planner or economic development or that kind of thing, then you just contact the city and those meetings can be set.
Okay.
There are a few different ways you can proceed. So I tell you what, why don't you call the city, call the law office, and call economic development, and we'll get meetings set.
Okay. Appreciate it.
Okay. Thank you.
We look forward to working with you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, that concludes our correspondence. We come to new business now. First on agenda is billing for Truck City of Gary Incorporated. I think we have a representative from the street department. Do we have anything on it?
Hello, my name is Ryan Edmonds. I'm the street commissioner for the city of East Chicago. And I'm here to reference this. These were a couple bills that was disputed maybe 2 years ago almost. And we had a meeting last week and Monday that we want to pay these bills. So I was told to bring it to the Board of Works. I believe Val, you know about the meeting, and so that's the reason for me being here. Mm-hmm. I think it's a total of $804, I believe, maybe $805 and some cents.
Mm-hmm. Just for information for the board, we're having discovering some bills from several years back, and we're trying to clear these issues up. And we decided it'd be better to bring these incidents that come up before the public and before a public board, so everybody could be informed what's occurring, and also for the benefit of state board accounts, so they could we could show them that through no fault of ours, something has occurred, it's been discovered, or in this case, there might have been a dispute and it dragged on for several years, and we're trying to just put closure on these issues. So I think your request is for the board to grant, finalize this bill, and it's with who?
With Truck City of Gary, Indiana.
And for an amount of $800?
I think it's $800, and I got it here somewhere. Where is it at? I think it's $805, I do believe.
Mm-hmm. And you have been in discussion with the city, with the law department and the controller?
Yes.
So everybody, that's why you referred to the Board of Works. I think I would like to entertain a motion where we could finalize this invoice with Truck City, which is 2 years old, for $805.
It might be one feeder, I'm not for sure. Do you remember? You was in the meeting. I didn't write it down.
There are two different invoices, but they total up to the $805.
Right. Right.
So if we're ready, I'll do the motion.
Okay.
I move that we approve the invoices from Truck City of Gary and give the controller's office permission to pay these older invoices.
Okay.
I second the motion.
Roll call.
Gomez?
Yes.
Jethro Rodriguez?
Yes.
Carla Morgan?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next on agenda is the Carey Street property. Yes. Can I have your name, sir, and address?
My name is Javier Chavez. I'm a real estate broker, a commercial residential, and also an instructor of real estate. We're from Macaulay Real Estate, 2045th Street in Highland, Indiana. Mm-hmm. I am working presently on a sale of a property which is located at 4135 Carey. The property is a 30-foot by 100-foot lot. Right next to it, there is a 20-foot by 100-foot lot that has never been used. That parcel belongs to the city of East Chicago. The city of East Chicago, the plats of the area, there were 66-foot right-of-ways. They developed them all, which includes the sidewalk, the greenery, the street, the greenery, and the sidewalk. Well, at the tail end of this block, which is on 142nd Street, going towards the west, it was pretty much abandoned. No, it has never been manicured, but the owners of the property right next to it have used it since it's manicured it, put a fence line, put a driveway. Now, the only access to their garage is through this parcel of property, which belongs to the city of East Chicago. You have numerous areas in the city of East Chicago which present owners are using as their property for whatever, and with no legal easements or approved. Now, NIPSCO does have power lines there, but there is no recorded document in the county for an easement for NIPSCO, nor is there an easement from the city. This property right now has been used, and pretty much the future owner with the new guidelines from the bank is landlocked. He can't go in his garage without entering a crossing or encroaching on your property to go in. Now, this property was sold to the previous owner about 34 years ago. Statutory law states that if after at the most 30 years people use property that has not been inspected and used, they can go through the process, a judicial process, adverse possession, in which the city can elect if they choose to grant it per deed, or right now what we're only requesting is usage as an easement, which means if there at any time or that you would require to use that property, you can. You know, but all we want is an easement for people to enter their garage and use it, and they manicure it and they'll do the whole thing. Right across from that property, you have the same situation. And you have other various parcels where there's city property that the present owners are manicuring and taking care of, that if you're looking at future sales, you're going to be involved with the same situation, the same problem, where title companies will not insure over parcels that are not part of the sale, and loan companies will not approve the loan unless the title company insures that parcel of land. So therefore, we're requesting an easement from the city just for usage and to enter it, granting it, in which at that time, if that's approved by the board, then we would provide the legal survey. It's a 20-foot by 100-foot. You can't build another building there. Minimum lots are 30 by 100. You can't do anything with that property. So it makes sense for the owner to take care of it, grant them an easement. It's still your right-of-way, not taking that away from it, and yet you don't have to maintain it, which means you grant it, we get a legal document that's a recordable document prepared along with the survey with the granting party of the Board of Works. We send it to the title company. They indeed get it recorded. That gets recorded. We get the title work to the bank. The bank approves it, we're clear to close. Here we have the buyer, a Schererville resident, wanting to come back to East Chicago. And this is holding the deal from happening on this. It's this, and that's pretty much where we're at. And I would be willing to work with you in other aspects where you have the same issues that need to be rectified, because what this does, it delays sales, it turns buyers away, and they move on.
Okay. If I can address some of the background and the procedural issues. Mm-hmm. One is Mr. Chavez came and met with me about a week and a half ago or so. Mm-hmm. In the law office here in the city. And we discussed this and looked up the plat of survey, which does show that this right-of-way is part of a much larger right-of-way that the city does own. So the city has title to it. And yeah. Okay. And because of that, the Board of Works does has the right and the ability to grant easements in that right-of-way. And those are pictures that he just brought to this meeting. So, and again, that is true that along 142nd, this is the situation with more than one property, where driveways can only be entered from, you know, across the city's right-of-way. And now to address the issue of the procedure, is the procedure I suggest is that, and we sort of discussed this, is that we need a legal description of the plot that you're asking to have the easement granted. You said that you have a real estate attorney who's going to draw that up.
We can. It's a choice. I know your schedule's timely, but I do have a real estate attorney on staff. We also got the survey crew. We've got the title company. It's all under the same umbrella, which would make the transaction fluent. Then he would be able to do it, providing he gets the grantors and the survey, the legal.
The grantor is the City of Chicago Board of Works.
Okay.
Would potentially be the grantor of it.
Correct.
So when he draws that up, if he can have it read the City of Chicago by the City of Chicago's Board of Works, that'll suffice.
Okay.
And then once we receive that legal description, then this board can consider it.
Mm-hmm.
We need it prior to the meeting, so just legally I can take a look at it and make sure it's accurate.
Okay.
And then we can have it on the agenda of our next meeting to, you know, vote it up or down. for the easement. And then once the board has voted yea or nay on granting the easement, if the answer is yes, then you can take that document and record it at the county, and then you can move forward with the transaction. Mm-hmm. The title company should be able to guarantee
no problem.
That from there. So I don't know if there were questions or other issues.
My only question is, so this isn't particular, there's other properties like the same
situation.
Right
across the street. As a matter of fact, you see it there, the one across the street, same situation.
So as we address...
On the photograph there, on the last picture on the photograph, same situation.
So as we address your situation, should we make plans how do we, you know, resolve all the rest?
That is something when we met that we discussed granting it for more than that. So there were some conversations in the city about getting descriptions all along 142nd and reviewing which properties have driveways that cross that. And so I've talked to our city planner maybe twice about this. And so he's working on a GIS system, but he's working to get identify the parcels where this is an issue, and not only on 142nd if there are other properties. And there are.
Yeah.
I'm from the harbor. I know that there are others.
Yeah.
So on the one hand, we want to, as quick as is reasonable, take care of this for this property so as not to stop that transaction, because we love the idea that we're attracting, you know, East Chicago folks back to town who moved elsewhere. But we do want to make sure we do this right. So we do plan on revisiting the issue for other properties along that corridor.
And I'm kind of glad that this happened, because I'm also an East Chicago born resident. I do want to see people come back in here. And you have a few where all the garage entryways are off street property. There's no alleyways. So they're all encroaching, and we've been doing this in the city. So it's numerous areas that need to be seen, in which if that's taken care of, then when a sale happens or people want to buy it, it'll be all set and done. And no delays. Time's of an essence in real estate, as we know.
Okay. Okay, so you're going to get that. You're going to work with the law department then?
Sure.
To get this?
Whatever Ms. Morgan says.
Do you think you can have that done?
I'll have it done by next week.
Okay.
Well, the thing is the survey I hope they have done by, hopefully this Friday. We get the survey. I will go ahead and give the attorney the grantor's name. Mm-hmm. He'll do all the paperwork documentation. I can bring in the legal, the survey, and a legal document for review.
Okay. Olga, when's our next regular meeting? Okay. If I can have it, you know, maybe 3-4 business days before,
sure,
then I can review it and we can have it ready to go. What's your deadline to be on the agenda, Olga? Okay, if I can get it the Thursday prior?
Well, you know, see how attorneys are busy all the time. It depends on his schedule, you know. So I'm going to do everything in my power to expedite the process. You probably get it as soon. The way I work, you'll probably get it sooner than you want it. It's up to their schedule.
Okay, as long as, again,
you'll get it.
Yeah, the law office, we can review it, and okay, then we'll submit it to Olga, who sets our agenda. So.
Okay, so you're giving me the approval of using a real estate attorney then?
I don't know. It's kind of dodgy when you say approval. Of course, you can use a real estate attorney.
Okay.
And
well, I didn't want to take away any rights from anyone else. I have first right of refusal type thing. You know.
Then I'm not even sure if we did a motion today, how we'd frame the motion that. Mm. You know, we think you should move forward.
Okay, I'll pursue it the way that I have it planned.
Give it every consideration when you present it.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, this doesn't require any motion of any type?
No, just that we're taking it under consideration.
Okay. Okay, so we will take that under consideration. Next on agenda is a change order number 10 for the bike trail project. If I could have your name and company and address.
Good evening, Board. My name is Joe Dubiel with American Structure Point, 2809 Suite B in Highland, or Highway Avenue, Suite B in Highland, Indiana. This is change order 10 for the East Chicago Bike Trail project. This change order resulted while excavating for the storm sewer, per plan storm sewer installation. The excavated material set for spoil disposal in the original contract was suspected to be contaminated. The haul site would not accept the material. The regular dump site would not accept the material, so it had to be tested and disposed of in a landfill per item and NDOT regulations. IDEM was contacted, and with their instruction, the soil was tested for contaminants. The change order packet that you have, there's a spreadsheet listed as a PCO 13 cost breakdown. I don't know what page it is in your packet. There were 6 samples taken for and tested for TCLP, lead, and a BTEX testing. The pricing for each one of those tests is listed, as well as removal and disposal of the material, which is manifested and documented. The actual amount of material was weighed at the landfill and is paid as a per ton disposal fee.
And this comes to, if I'm reading this right, $20,761?
Yep, $20,761.46.
Mm-hmm. Let me have that copy. Jesse, I have a question for our city engineer.
I review this already, and I mean, here we have all the information that we need, basically the information to justify the volume of the soil excavated and tested and contaminated. So it was an unforeseen condition, so we didn't expect contaminated soil. Basically, we have to follow rules and based on contract specs, and we involve IDEM on this, so we did right.
And what was the source of the contamination? Why was it deemed contaminated?
It's at the soil was from the Columbus and the Railroad Avenue and Columbus Avenue intersection. We believe there's an old pipeline up in that area, but it was never confirmed. The pipelines were called and locates called, and there was nothing that was identified that was indeed the result of the contamination. Mm-hmm. There's the oil fields up there, and there was suspected areas up there, but there's nothing identified of where the contaminants came from.
So it was definitely identified that petroleum was a contaminant.
And right. It was the test results. I believe it's identified as petroleum impacted soil. Is how they identify it, and the test for the TCLP lead and BTEX rule out that it's actually any sort of leaded gas or that requires even special.
So it's basically crude.
Right. I don't believe the process actually identifies what the contaminants are, other than identify that they're not lead and the BTEX chemicals. So.
Any questions?
No. There's a spreadsheet with the total volume, cost, and here all the information needed for this. You can see the price. You can see the total volume, and green markup, et cetera.
Okay. So it was 262 tons?
Right.
Okay. There's load tickets and everything was weighed before contaminating.
So the load tickets is all this information attached here. You will see here tons 19.7, second one 19.67. Mm-hmm. So the total it's 263.
Yeah, well.
Right, so we have the evidence. Show the cause of everything.
Now, I know we have pipelines running by there. We're certain this is from an old leak, not something that's occurring now?
All the pipelines were called, and they all came out, and everything that they have that is live is on the west side, or on the east side of the street. Okay. And this construction was all on the west side of the street. So they all came out and identified that it was nothing that they, you know, were aware of or knew about.
Okay, so that was all checked out?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Jesse, do you have an opportunity to speak with the controller?
About the corporate cost of this?
Right.
Yeah, well, I sent an email to the financial advisor, Mr. Bennett, and I have the okay from him. However, there are a lot of deduction on these projects, so we're under budget, so we don't even need to open another PO to cover the expense of this. At the end of the project, we need to go through all the items that were installed, no install, and create a final change order, which would be less than the budget that we expected.
So for the record, we're still within the budget.
We're still within the budget.
Require necessary.
Even also, I have the okay, but I had a meeting yesterday with Mr. Dubiel, and we review all the items, and we are going to have savings on this project, especially when we eliminate a lot of work on Railroad Avenue, and we are doing part of that those items in the overpass bridge.
Okay. I'll entertain a motion that we accept change order number 17 for the Railroad Avenue project. Is there a number on, let's see, under contract number R29605, change order number 10.
Number 10, yeah. Did you say the amount?
For the amount of $20,761.46.
So move.
Second.
Roll call.
Gomez?
Yes.
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 Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Next on the agenda, we have Hasse Construction Broadway Project. Oh, and here I was thinking you were here for the bridge. This is a Hasse Construction Broadway Project.
There's a change order number 17.
Oh, wait a minute. You know, I apologize. You are right. Thank you. Next one is the Railroad Avenue Project. Sorry. I have to get new glasses.
It's okay. My name is Keith Blanton. I'm with RQAW Corporation here on behalf of the City and Railroad Avenue project. This is contract B30359, presenting change order number 17. This change order represents the addition of a chain link fence around the pump station, the new location of the pump station at the northeast corner of Chicago and Railroad Avenue. This is a security issue, and so the addition is for a security fence. The cost of the additional fence and gate is $6,752.
Okay, question for our city engineer.
I reviewed this. This is more for security reason. We discussed this with the sanitary district. They think that would be a good idea to secure the area and put some kind of fence and gate so people won't have access to the pump station, just for security purpose. And we're still under budget in this project. So we decide to move forward with this, even that you see there is a the total change today will be $140,348.63, but there's still some items that we need at the end of the project we need to deduct, and we'll be fine, we'll be under budget. So and we have the they're okay from the state as well on this.
Out of curiosity, is there any other security, like an alarm on that pump station or?
No. Not for theft, no.
No?
Not for
Do
theft.
Do we have any on other pump stations or basically just a fence around them?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't think so. That's a question mm-hmm. for maybe the sanitary district director.
Okay.
They didn't recommend kind of alarm system, so I don't think they have mm-hmm. alarm system in other.
I was just wondering. You know, it seems like we're getting more scrappers and people breaking into things mm-hmm. lately. I was just mm-hmm. wondering about that. Okay, are there any more questions?
No.
Okay, can I entertain a motion to accept change order number 17 for contract number B30359 for the amount of $6,752?
So move.
Second.
Roll call.
Bel Gomez.
Yes.
Jethro Rodriguez.
Yes.
Carla Morgan.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, now on agenda is Hasse Construction Broadway Project. Is there anybody in the audience representing Hasse Construction? Since there's no one here from Hasse Construction, we're gonna bypass this item. Next on agenda is 3834 to 36 Butternut from the Building Department.
Good evening, Wina Guzman, Interim Building Commissioner. I'm here reference to 3834 Butternut. This property is in violation of IC 3679, the Unsafe Building Law, and warrants emergency demolition as the structure's roof has partially collapsed, compromising the stability of the remaining structure. It also poses an immediate danger to passersby and vehicular traffic, as it is in close proximity to the public right-of-ways. The Board of Safety has entered an order to demolish on September 14, 2011 on this property, and as of today's date, the owner has failed or refused to comply. As a result, the Building Department has requested proposals to proceed with emergency demolition of this property, which they have been submitted to you. I also have photos I would like to share with you if you'd like to see them. So I asked today that this board open the sealed envelopes before this public meeting, and upon my receipt of the proposals, I will review them and make my recommendation at the next Board of Public Works meeting.
Yeah. Do you know approximately how long that building has been vacant?
It's been vacant for some time.
For decades, or?
Trying to see if I.
Pictures.
It's been abandoned and vacant for approximately seven mm-hmm. plus years.
Ms. Guzman, you said there is an owner, it's not abandoned? Or there isn't
yes,
an owner on record?
I'm unable to contact the owner, communicate with the owner. We've served him, notifications have been properly served. However, he has not responded. We've sent him an emergency notice to demolish due to the roof collapsing. We've attempted to have him appear before the Board of Public Safety. He's failed to appear, so he's basically failed to adhere to any of our notices, communications.
And without having my file in front of me, and correct me if I have some of this wrong, but I do believe he's an out-of-town real estate investor. I believe he most
yes.
likely picked this. I know that the address was out of town. He had multiple addresses
mm-hmm.
None of which were in Indiana.
Homewood, Illinois, Chicago, Illinois. We have, there's additional attachments to the property, liens as well.
I believe he acquired it from a tax sale, but then never really invested in it to develop it or bring it up to code?
I'm not sure about that. I'm not aware of that.
Okay, but you don't have at hand any records of permits being pulled to repair the property, even after you served notice of the condition?
You know, way back when, I think it's been more than 7 years.
Okay, but...
Yeah, it's one in 2003, I see here. Tuck pointing, patch job on Briggs. Let's see if there's any more here. It's one in 2000. Paint the interior of garage. It's minor work.
Now, this might be more questions for legal, but are we going to pursue to recuperate our and any means of recuperating costs?
Yes.
Oh, well, yes, definitely. Yes, that's part of our process.
Just for the record, it's part of our regular process to try to...
Yes, and what I'll do once we obtained all the bills, all the invoices have been processed, we'll place a lien against that property. As well, I'm going to try to pursue also imposing a civil penalty against the owner for failing to adhere to our orders and to the Board of Safety orders.
Yeah. And we can follow through to the point of attaching his other properties if he continues to show failure to comply with any of this, which he's not responded. So
yes, no, I haven't received one call. I've even attempted to go on internet looking for this number. I've called several times, a number that I've found under this name. No, I haven't been successful in that.
Which is above and beyond what the law requires you to do.
Yes.
The owner's address is supposed to be correct as listed in the county's records, both the county recorder and the tax office. So
yes.
So you've done.
And we also obtained a title search too. So, but to no avail.
Are they in default of their taxes? Or
I'm sorry.
Have they kept up with their taxes?
Or
do we know or?
No. I haven't.
I don't
shows
believe
on the title
this
search.
Was on the most recent tax sale, but I can check that. We can check it together.
Yeah, we could check to see what on his other properties, whether this gentleman's keeping up on the taxes or what's the condition of those properties.
2010, he didn't pay. Effective June 24, 2011, current amount due in taxes was $2,466.77. Which, if he is paying the taxes, maybe that's a good thing. So if once we attach it, maybe we can recoup those monies, possibly.
I'm
hopeful.
That's what I was hoping for. Okay, so today you're asking us to open the three bids for demolition?
Yes, I received three on today's date.
Okay. So, just like before, we'll open the bids, we'll read them out, and then we'll submit them back to your department, make sure everything is proper on their paperwork?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. Okay, so we'll start with Acton Incorporated. Acton Incorporated, 1102 East Columbus Drive, Post Office Box 518 in Chicago, Indiana. Their proposal is for $67,450. The next one's from National Wrecking Company. From 2441 North Levette Street, Chicago, Illinois, 60647. Consideration, the sum of $111,900. That's from National Wrecking Company, 2441 North Levette Street, Chicago, Illinois, 60647. Third and final one is from JM Industrial Services Incorporated, 201 Marble Street, Hammond, Indiana, 46327. The amount of their bid is for $63,800. That's the final bid. We'll take an advisement. We'll present all the bids to you, and you'll make sure everything's proper.
Then I'll make my recommendations at the next scheduled meeting. Yes.
Right.
I also will bring the board up to date as far as the demolitions at the next meeting as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Next on agenda is right-of-way applications from the engineering department.
Okay, I'm going to start with the first permit application number. It's a permit number 11-01838, permit type utility, location 144th Bering Avenue, description street drain repair in need of blacktop. Next one, 11-01839, permit type utility, location 4605 Magoon Avenue, description manhole repair in street resurface with blacktop. Next one, 11-01840, permit type utility, location 3823 Evergreen Street, description manhole repair in need of blacktop resurfacing. Next one, 11-01841, permit type right-of-way, location 2200 East Chicago Columbus Drive, East Columbus Drive, description temporary construction fence around site to encompass alleyway on north side of lot. Next one, permit application number 11-01842, permit type dumpster, description location 1309 West 150th Street, description locate dumpster at curb in front of resident. 11-01843, permit type right-of-way, location 5400 Roxana Drive, description access drive for equipment onto Roxana March area near Grand Calumet River Project. 11-01844, permit type dumpster, location 1122 West 151st Street, description locate dumpster at curb in front of resident. 11-01845, permit type dumpster, location 4753 Grasselli Avenue, description locate dumpster at street, curb in front of resident. 11-01846, Permit type right-of-way, location 4000 White Oak Street, description excavate, possible dewatering and repair of BP Amoco pipeline under easement. Job site 2011-0148, 2011-014B, and 2011-016. Next one, 11-01847, permit type heavy load, location 3858 Michigan Avenue, description Michigan Avenue to Kennedy Avenue to Chicago Avenue to Industrial Avenue to Clark Road. 11-01848, permit type heavy load, location 3212 Watling Street, description driving load via Kennedy Canal, Indiana Harbor Drive, and Riley Road. And the last one, 11-01849, permit type heavy load, location 3400 Dickey Road, description from Middle Dock onto Dickey Road, 229th Street, BP Amoco plant. Mm-hmm. All the permits have been reviewed by engineering department, and they're going to need a motion for approval.
Mm-hmm. I move that we approve permits number 11-0838 through 11-01849.
I'll second. Roll call.
Val Gomez.
Yes.
Jethro Rodriguez.
Yes.
Carla Morgan.
Yes.
Okay. Is there any old business? Any other business? Our next regular meeting will be Wednesday, November 10th, 2011 at 4:30. As there being no other business, I'd like to entertain a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
Roll call.
Val Gomez.
Yes.
Jethro Rodriguez.
Yes.
Carla Morgan.
Yes.
Okay. And that concludes our meeting.
Okay, we'll call to order the regular meeting of the Board of Public Safety. Today's date's October 26, 2011. We begin our meetings by recitation of the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge allegiance to the flag, United States of America,
and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all.
For the record, may we have a roll call, Madam Secretary?
Richard Morrisville.
Present.
Richard Tremzinski.
Present.
Thomas Davis.
Present.
Okay, we need approval of the October 12, 2011 minutes without reading.
I move that they be approved.
I second the motion.
Subject to editing as if needed.
I'll second the motion.
Still okay, bad. Roll call.
Richard Morrisville.
Approve.
Richard Tremzinski.
Approve.
Thomas Davis.
Approve.
Okay, first item on the agenda is the business of the code enforcement. I understand Miguel Arredondo will be addressing the board.
Thank you.
Great.
Good evening.
Good evening,
Mr. Arredondo.
My name is Miguel Arredondo. I am the divisional manager for code enforcement. Two things is that I want to thank the board for allowing me to come and present to you, and I will be doing this on a monthly basis and at least give you updates, as the building department has been doing previously. I will be doing that and giving you about a monthly roundup of what we had done the previous month. But to start off, you should have received in your packages two documents from me. They're almost the exact same documents. They're just going to be from two different years. And if you look in the dates on them, one is going to be from 2010 and one's going to be from 2011. A little explanation on what these documents are is we had a meeting between the administration and the controller's office, along with our attorney, Mr. Lopez, and code enforcement, which had to do with when throughout the summers we've been making out reports and having a system followed through of when we have the violation of our city ordinance of weeds and vegetation. and that's when they have an excess of over 6 inches on property of weeds and vegetation. We go through a process, and I'll go quickly through that, is that one, we leave a tag on the residents to tell them they're in violation. It explains it on the tag itself. It's a green tag, and if you see them throughout the city, you'll see that's where we've they're mostly abandoned buildings. The second thing is when the inspector comes to back to the station, what we do is have them make a report, and in that report we identify through the assessor's website who the property owner is. The property owner will then receive a letter to themselves telling that they have 5 days to remedy the violation and come in compliance. For 2011, we had approximately 1,100 of these violations. The good news is that about 5 to 550 of them remedied their violations without any more concerns. Approximately 600 didn't. From the 600 that do not, we then send a work order to General Services. Now, this is in 2011. I was to send them a work order, and at that time, General Services Director would either have it done by the city, and that's where you see on your one side that says CNN. If you see a C, that is the city. When you see any other initials, it's actually the initials of a company that the General Service Director would have hired to do those type of works. All we have here is the names of the owners with the address that was actually cut at, with the date, and on top you can see on your columns it tells you the dates that I made the actual work order, the dates that you actually did perform the works, and then the amounts that were due. On the extreme right side, you'll also see very few, but there is some check numbers. Those are the people who actually paid us in that. The good and bad news about it is that we haven't really had to do anything with people who actually live and own homes. As a matter of fact, I could say that of the 1,100 violations, there might have been 10 of homeowners that actually did it, and they remedied their situation right away. The other ones are either rentals from people who live outside the city of East Chicago and have renters there, and it's a dispute usually between landlords and renters of who's going to cut it, and we tell them that's not for us to worry about, that's for them to take care of and between themselves and to remedy the situation. Most of them get it done, but the vast majority of the ones that you have in front of you, because you'll see sometimes the same address over and over, is going to be vacant and abandoned buildings. That's the same buildings that you'll see Commissioner Guzman come up here and talk to you from the building department are ones we're hitting with getting our grasses cut. I wanted to bring this to your attention because now you have the updated list at this time where we are with them. The last thing, the reason we had this meeting was what have we and have we done everything that we should have to the letter of the law and in compliance with state statute, and we have done that from the beginning in 2010 on. The very last process that would possibly have to be done, and this is right now in communication with our city attorney and our corporate counsel, along with Attorney Lopez, is that do we have to put liens on the properties? We have even, myself and my administrative assistant today, Ms. Gloria Morales, updated the list. You do not have this paperwork. I have that, but to give you an example of it, we actually identified through the tax records those that would possibly be paid and collectible by a lien, and those are probably going to sit dormant and just be laying out there. There is a cost factor to putting liens on properties. We didn't want to go to that excess with another cost to the city and not be able to recoup that. But we've identified of these approximately 600 properties that you have in front of you, about 350 that may be able to be collectible. That will be identified, that will be brought to you at a status report for our next meeting of what actually will actually transpire with the last part of it, which is the possible liens on these properties. And then, if you have any questions, I'm here to answer them for you.
Just for the record, if you'd give us the names of the different companies, C is city, and then we have PNS, RK, Acton, and STM, and just so that we know who those are.
STM is actually STM Enterprise. The RK actually is a regional something. These were all hired through the General Service Director. PNS, I'm not exactly sure what the proper names of it, but it's a PNS something incorporated.
Okay. And do you know is there any pattern to how they're assigned?
I would say by looking at it, in 2010, that's when I actually handled the direct going to the vendors. I went by districts. I had a Harbor, I had an East Chicago, and then I had a Calumet New Edition Marktown area. And it kind of evened out.
And the other, the 2011 seemed somewhat similar?
I handed everything to General Services and they would do it. But it seemed to be that they kind of went the same way, with the exception that if somebody was bogged down with some extra work, he would try to send it out to others. I will say that Mr. Edmonds did a fine job this year of getting a lot of work done by the city. So those were not something that came to a cost to the city. It's just trying to recoup some money, but not the cost to the city per se. We didn't have to pay anybody out.
I just have one last mark. It seems that for reporting that pretty much if you do it through October, like June through October, mm-hmm. and then maybe something at the end of the year, that would be pretty good rather than fretting about a monthly report. I mean, in other words, we have the growing season when you're hiring and like looking at the records and all of this, is pretty much June through September.
Yeah, this is probably going to be your last report about this. What I was explained to you by reporting to you is what other things that the board, that code enforcement does.
Okay.
And that because there's many other things that we do besides
okay.
this.
Okay, that's fine. No, I understand
yes.
that then.
Yes, this is about it for this year.
There's going to be a list of those properties that are collectible versus uncollectible. Are we still working through that?
We did that today.
Okay.
I just wasn't able to give you that copy.
All right.
And all I did was go through the exact same copies and said, Gloria went through it and said, this one has a $50,000, this one's got $10,000, $20,000, and you'd just be another lien on it compared to this one owes $2,200 and maybe probably could get it paid.
I know that Kim Anderson wanted to see
yes.
that information.
And I had that discussion with her this afternoon.
Okay, good. And you'll be making a recommendation to the board as to what's collectible and what isn't?
I'm going to actually be showing this list to the attorneys and ask them exactly, because I do have some documentation correspondence from Attorney Allegretti, and ask them exactly how they want to proceed that. And when that's done, which will be by our next meeting a month from now, I'll come back and tell you this is what's going to happen.
And then the board will be in a position to make a recommendation to the Board of Public Works. And so that's why I was bringing it up.
Yes.
So that should happen at the next meeting.
Yes, I'll have you, because it'll be these same addresses you have, but just tell you what we think may be collectible. And if collectible, I think as Attorney Lopez and I discussed earlier, because of the cost on even just adjusting the liens, that we just keep adding on more cost to us.
And so if we then would accept this and hand it on to the Board of Works, Mr. Lopez, is that?
He'll make a recommendation, you guys will vet it, and either make a recommendation or not.
But probably that's what'll happen.
I would anticipate.
Yes.
We'll make a recommendation after speaking to.
Ms. Anderson had a question to us about that the procedure she wants to go through because of the State Board of Accounts. Of what are you doing with this? There is a state within the statute about us as a city trying to recoup our money. Just so everybody, let everybody know that everybody that you have here, we sent them that documentation saying that you owe us this money in the invoice. And then some have paid, some have not. Now that comes the next part, we now put liens on the property. Okay?
What type of success are we having over in city court with issuing?
We haven't got to that point with ourselves. More the building department's been using it. We haven't simply because of the last conversation I had with our city attorney. We're going to see that hopefully something will start very soon in the process of having the inspectors through ordinance amendment being able to issue those themselves. And I happen to keep calling the police over to do it.
As of now, there's been nothing, none have been filed in city court?
No, no.
No collection action?
No, no. No, it's just strictly with us sending them documentation.
What's the ratio of send-outs to return? It looks almost like about 2-to-1.
Oh, the returns have always been very minimal, and that's because they are basically abandoned, vacant. A good example is one of the buildings there. By the time we called who we believe was the bank that had it, they sold it to Freddie Mac. Freddie Mac, we got a hold of them. They said 2 days ago we sold it to this place out of Virginia. And then in the tracking of it, and we're trying to collect, you know, $80. I think I spend $110 in phone calls trying to get to them. So.
Just one question.
Yes, sir.
In case you don't get any returns from, say,
yes,
quite a few of them, what are your plans on doing with that property?
That is going to be the part that we will have for you next meeting to see whether we're going to put liens on the properties. And then once we do that, whoever gets control of paying the taxes on that property would have to pay this lien. But again, as I told this to both our administration and our controller's office, being that the majority of these are abandoned buildings, you know, until somebody buys it at the sales, then you won't be picking up that money yet. Okay.
So, isn't the city sometimes the preferred lien holder in or is it? It can be.
They have priority.
So even if there is a lot of other, if it's
yes,
if
it's yeah, that's the biggest problem's been so far is that the properties are into the third tax sale without anybody buying them. And so because of that, you know, they're going to keep sitting there. Okay.
Any other questions for Miguel Arredondo?
Thank you very much. I appreciate your time.
If we may accept your report, we'll move to accept them.
Second?
I second it.
Roll call.
Richard Morrisville?
Accept.
Richard Chemzinski?
Accept.
Thomas Davis?
Accept.
Thank you, Mr. Arredondo.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Next item on the agenda is the business of the building department.
Good evening. Weena Guzman, Interim Building Commissioner, City of East Chicago Building Department. Well, I am submitting written reports for the month of October 2011, which reflect building departmental activities regarding board ups, call outs, demolition, and notices to vacate. So if you'd like to review that, and if you would like for me to elaborate on any property, please let me know.
You have two or three basements that are
yes
tentatively ordered mm-hmm. to be vacated.
Yes.
Do you kind of have a program of looking for those, or how do they happen to occur that they get to your attention and you take action on?
Say if individual comes in to they're renting, their NIPSCO was shut off, or they someone moved out of there, so they need to reinstate the NIPSCO services. What they have to do is come, NIPSCO sends them to the building department for inspection. They come to our department, then we go out there and inspect. And that's when
how
we,
it comes
yes,
to your attention.
Yes, most of them, yes. Unless we get a call, complaint, and then we'll address it in that manner.
So usually somebody is leaving and there's a new tenant situation, or
For most part, yes. You know, NIPSCO, they're coming in for, I don't know if they're leaving, but I know say or they haven't paid their bill.
Okay.
It could be that case as well. But they would come to us. They would request a NIPSCO service inspection from the building department. Then once we go out there, once our inspector goes, he identifies whether or not the apartment, and we sometimes ask, is there, we always ask actually, if there's a basement apartment, and we go look at the basement. We always look at the basement regardless. Mm-hmm. Yes. And as far as the demolitions, I don't know if you want to go over the demolitions. City's looking better.
Yes.
2019 Broadway, that is down. It has been backfilled. We are, what I'm going to do is I'm going to send a letter thanking the owner of record, which is the bank, for expeditiously responding and cooperating in abating the unsafe conditions there. They took down the whole building at their expense. The city did not have to incur any expenses relating to that demolition. So I am going to be sending a letter thanking them on behalf of the city.
The bank was?
Yes, the bank.
Which what bank was?
You know what, I don't, I can't recall.
Out of town bank or local bank?
Yes, out of town, Chicago. Okay. The other properties on the list, which is 2304, 2308, 2316 through 20, actually those are being demolished and to make way for new construction for the senior citizen building. Thirty-eight, thirty-four through 36 Butternut, as I know the board members were here, but there was we received proposals on today's date. They opened the proposals before the Board of Public Works meeting, and I will be reviewing them and making my recommendations at the next Board of Works meeting, and I will keep the board apprised.
And one question about that. It was a lodge. The lodge moved to Pulaski.
Yes.
Can they then just abandon it? I mean, they don't carry any liability to?
They do. No. I mean, we've reached out and, you know, we properly serve the notices. I've attempted to communicate directly with the owner and nothing. I haven't received any response.
I mean, the lodge as an entity kind of washes its hands of it? And
I don't think the lodge is no longer in existence. I think the building was abandoned, period.
But didn't the lodge move to the old Dawkins building across from the bank on Pulaski?
You know what, I don't even think that they're involved. When I did the title search, no, I didn't see the lodge listed on there. No. So if they're not involved, they're not attached to that property.
Okay.
Yeah. But 723 Chicago Avenue, that one, again, that was an unsafe structure, has been demolished. We will be pursuing collection of costs incurred for the demolition services rendered by the city. 422 Spring, again, that was unsafe structure. It has been demolished. That's over on...
The baby is still living?
I'm sorry?
I think of it as Siamese twins, those structures.
Oh, yeah, the rest of them, yes. But slowly, you know, we'll address them. We're trying to, I know we brought one individual before this board, 418 Lilac, and he is slowly but surely moving forward with the repairs there. So we're trying to educate the residents as well, not just going in there full force and taking down their buildings, but you know, we have to make sure that, you know, they address the concerns that we have on the violations.
I keep waiting for some major benefactor to look at Marktown as an opportunity rather than as a problem.
Yes, there are a lot of abandoned buildings there, and yes, some of them have to be addressed. We continuously get calls to board up buildings.
For instance, in Chicago next week, there's a lecture by the on the architect Howard Van Dorn Shaw and the wonderful things he's done, and
mm-hmm.
focusing on his buildings. And it's a new book being autographed, and I keep hoping that I'd bump into some fat there who'd decide that the working community that he also developed is significant.
And, the residents, I think, need to come together and really work hard on trying to bring that area up. I'm told that
owners have generally been positive,
mm-hmm.
but renters sometimes not very helpful at all.
Yeah.
So.
But yeah, so again, we will be pursuing collection of costs incurred for the demolition services rendered by the city. And also, we want to pursue the penalty assessed by this board. I want to vigorously pursue this, and I will be bringing it back to the table as far as the penalty. And I think that completes my report. Oh, actually, no. I have one more item. I also provided you with the updated listing of cases brought before the city court for violations of city ordinances pertaining to no permits, no licenses. It's an updated copy. And to date, we've issued 30 summonses on violations of city ordinances. Since we commenced this, we've been going every Friday to city court, you know, to process these cases.
He's got a court date coming up pretty soon, isn't he?
I'm sorry.
This electric company?
Yes. Every Friday, like this Friday, I have to be there. Next Friday, I believe. Yeah, so the first couple pages is pending, and the balance of those pages, those are completed. Those are the ones that we've already attended city court for. Yes, and if you see at the bottom, that's how much we should be collecting in total.
I got one question.
Yes.
Reference to 409 Deal Street.
Yes.
Notice for emergency to be demolished. What about the whole house? Just one side or both sides? Was that duplex?
No, actually, that's to vacate. We vacated the. It was not fit for human habitation. 4009 Deal.
Yes.
Yes. No, actually, there was a fire there, and we had the services were completely terminated. We had to board up the building. Severe fire damage to the rear of the building, basement area. There was a large gaping hole that was left due to the fire. So we had to issue that because no one can reside there until it's brought up to code.
Okay.
Yes.
So it
and no
not
one's
be
to be in the building. Absolutely not. If not, they will be arrested.
Okay.
Do you have any clue as to whether or not it'll be rehabbed?
The owner has shown some interest. She has, you know, I have spoken with her. I've communicated with her. She boarded up the building. She was cooperative in doing that. So, yeah, I believe she will at one point, yes. But this is a precautionary measure because we don't want anybody entering the building and causing more damage, you know, another fire that can cause the adjacent, you know, building to catch on fire.
Okay.
And that completes my report.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
No more questions.
Motion to accept reports.
I so move.
Roll call.
Richard Morrisroll.
Accept.
Richard Chemzinski.
Accept.
Thomas Davis.
Accept.
Job well done.
Thank you.
Now, there's no other business before the board. Our next scheduled meeting is Wednesday, November 9th at 5:30. Motion to adjourn.
I so move.
Final roll call.
Richard Morrisville.
Adjourn.
Richard Chemzinski.
Adjourn.
Davis.
Adjourn.
That concludes our meeting.
I'd like to thank all the people who came to this meeting and for your attention. The dollar, 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 the dollar